From the tarmac heights of Monte Carlo to the ice and snow of Sweden, the hills of Portugal, along the dusty roads of the safari in Argentina, and through the village lanes of Corsica to the fast gravel roads of New Zealand. And defending world rally champ Carlos Sainz was trying to win for Lancia.
Winning three times, it was very nice, and I hope I can win the fourth time with the Lancia. In any case, we are going to have a very strong opposition with the three Subarus, with the two Toyotas, plus the two Ford.
Carlos Sainz, who's had a miserable year, leads a field of 76 cars on the 23rd Rally of New Zealand. Frenchman Didier Auriol started 93 with the win in Monte Carlo and was quickly on the pace in the car that's dominated this rally, the four-wheel drive, 2-litre turbo, 16-valve Toyota Celica. His teammate is triple world champ Juha Kankkonen, second on the driver's champs after wins in Kenya and Argentina. He won the Rothmans in 86 for Peugeot. The other flying Finn, Ari Vartanen, crashed out of the Acropolis while in the lead. Now the 81 world champ is determined to make up for that and give Subaru their first win in the World Rally Champs. Leading the Ford Challenge, Francois Delacour, and the Escorts are back in town. They've won the rally five times before. The 93 version, powered by Cosworth, has a 7-speed gearbox. Leg 1 on Thursday featured 9 special stages from the start at Manukau to the overnight halt in Rotorua, with regroups in Raglan and Otorohanga covering 483 kilometres. At the end of the first special stage, the short 2-kilometre sprint through Totara Park, Delacour does a 1 minute 15 seconds and is one of 5 drivers, just 2 seconds off the pace set by Juha Kankkonen, Didier Auriol and Carlos Sainz, and the fans get their first sight of the flying Ford. Teammate Mickey Biasion won the Acropolis Rally and leads the Drivers' Championship. It's the Italian's second time to New Zealand after finishing third 7 years ago. Scotland's Colin McRae has a real rally pedigree, son of British great Jimmy McRae. He's spectacular, but has the reputation of being reckless. He gave Subaru their best result in the World Champs this year with a third place in Sweden. Always on the case, but could he always stay on the road? Helping him do that, the multi-million dollar ProDrive factory team of Subaru.
We've got 4 main service barges like we've got here. With that we've got 4 support vehicles which carry personnel. They try to get to every stage, we go to every second stage to service the car. There's a helicopter circulating in the air right now. We use them mainly for communication. And also our HQ runs from the helicopter. There is a plane also circulating up there, used for communication. We've got 2 major trucks, real big trucks, loaded. We travel to them replenish our stocks of fuel and tyres and then carry on. We give them our old tyres, they take them back and they have the tyres changed and the fuel changed as well. Basically the main trucks carry identical spares in each truck, gearboxes, differentials, spares. The support vehicle mainly only carries vital parts that can be fitted in a hurry at the end of a stage. So each truck, like I say, is exactly the same with exactly the spare parts in it. And yeah, we've got enough parts to rebuild a car if we have to. Yeah.
Yeah. Could you put 80s in the warmers for Ari? 80s. 80. Okay, thanks.
Besides the tyres, engines and spare parts, the Subaru team also features a couple of Kiwis trying to take advantage of the professional backup.
Yeah, we've got a gravel car going through the stages ahead of us and they give me a page of updates on the pace notes that we made a week or so ago. So if there's any problems with slightly damp spots on corners that are out of character with the stage and they weren't there in our notes, then we can pick it all up and just cross-reference it back to our notes.
And after failing to get a car across the finish last year, the Subaru team and entire rally program was under intense pressure to perform, to take the 2.2 Legacy to victory against Ford and Toyota. But compare that level of support and service to India's Bharat Davi, the slowest car in the field, mainly because he kept getting lost.
You want to start 33?
Yeah, give it to you.
This way, next on the left.
Okay then.
About 3K.
Davi, driving the rather uniquely built Maruti Gypsy, had to do the entire rally without changing the tyres and couldn't afford to break down because his service crew beat him to it.
No. I was heading for the service vehicles, but 2 days before, my service vehicle has broken down and they say that we are unable to attend your service. So I say that if service vehicle fall down, there is no penalty. You can off the road and I will go. No worries about me, I can complete the rally.
Yes, without the service vehicle.
Without the service vehicle. Without the changes of any single tyre.
Only one spare wheel.
And moving in mysterious ways with the world stars, Kiwi Possenborn, fulfilling his dream of being part of a full factory team. And the three-sport rally cam shows Possum and co-driver Roger Freeth, our own flying doctor, at work behind the wheel. But the office is travelling at close to 200 kilometres per hour. And the amazing view from the front of the bumper, the three-sport Possum cam.
Right 4-5, blue flow right 4, keep moving. 50. Right 6-7, and 30. Low left 6, to a caution, low left 7, times to 4-5.
As you can see, the co-driver requires a lot of concentration and anticipation. Roger Freeth has to let Possum know what's coming up well before and what's coming up after every corner, so Possum knows just how fast he can go. Timing is critical. Three times national champ Neil Allport had little chance of defending his title. He was fifth and first Kiwi home in 91, sixth and first Kiwi home with Freeth in 86, and was going all out to do the same this year in the Mazda 323 GTR. And Wellington's Joe McAndrew just had to finish in the top four of the local drivers to take out the three-sport rally championship.
Reconnaissance has been really good. Pace notes, I love the pace notes. They're Rogers ones, they're just spot on and really pushes the car along, really pushes the Mesa through it. It's good.
The smallest car through here, isn't it?
It is, yeah, but you know, those Moto stages are pretty tight, so a small car's going to be great there, so it's not going to be a problem.
Judy DeLewa, co-driving for Vanessa Slee in the 660cc turbocharged Vivio. The Kiwi women were out to beat the French woman who leads the FISA Ladies Cup in the World Rally Champs, Christine Driano in the Citroën. After being seated 12th at the start, Driano spent most of her time going backwards quicker than she was going forwards. But at least she was still going, unlike Mickey Biasion. Few glimpses we've ended up seeing of him in action today. Rolled, and that was it. The finish of the rally for the man who leads the series. Unbelievable.
It's a real shame. You know, I was putting my money on him. The Ford looked great. He didn't seem to be pushing it too hard, but I guess that's what the sport of rallying is all about.
Mickey had an accident, but he's okay, and the co-driver is okay, but
the roads, and I think the car is at this point.
Now that you are by yourself with no teammate, are you going to slow down a little, or are you going to?
It's difficult to say. I think they need to finish the rally, of course, but also to get the best result, because we can be again in the first position in the World Championship. If I finish first, it's difficult for me.
Good luck.
Thank you.
The 31-year-old Frenchman Francois Delacour and his co-driver Daniel Gratteloup have been racing together since the Spanish Rally 2 years ago. Delacour scored his first win in the World Championship this year when he led Ford to a 1-2 finish in Portugal and followed that with a second victory of the season in Corsica. And the tarmac specialist was out to show he could also cut loose on the gravel roads in his first drive on Kiwi roads. The other Frenchman in the field, Didier Auriol, was another consistent top three performer. He was the fastest man on the World Rally Champs last year with 6 victories and should have taken the title, but retired in San Remo, had problems in Spain, and that let Carlos Sainz steal the championship with a late charge. This year, driving for the Works Toyota team, 34-year-old Auriol and his co-driver Bernard Acelli were determined to make the most of the Celica's amazing winning record on the Rothmans Rally of New Zealand. Carlos Sainz has won the race 3 times in a row. Could Auriol make it number 4 for Toyota? Ari Vartanen, one of the most popular drivers in the International, has been racing with 46-year-old Bruno Berglund since 1988. He's by far the most experienced of the Subaru drivers, been racing since 1974, won the World Championship in 1981, and has been second twice and finished third before in the Rothmans. Always super quick. And by the end of the first leg, Vartanen would be in front by just 4 seconds from the Lancia reigning world champ Carlos Sainz. So now sit back and enjoy the ride as Sainz and co-driver Luis Moya throw the Jolly Club Lancia around the tight, twisty corners he knows so well. Guys are going so fast, and that's it. Talking about going fast under pressure, the reigning world champion Carlos Sainz, how good is he in the Lancia?
Oh, he's fantastic. A lot of people have not given him much of a chance this year, seeing as Lancia aren't fully supporting this effort, but you know, he's a great driver. He's won here 3 times already.
He was the second fastest on stage 4, which of course was the killer stage. And talking about kills, here's Ross Dunkerton He's had problems with the throttle in stage one. Seems to be going okay at the moment.
Oh, he's got a problem. Look at the smoke coming out the back.
That is the commentator's kiss of death. Poor old Ross Dunkerton there. Looks like, what is that, a blown turbo?
Well, I know what that feels like. You know, I've had that problem. It's either a blown turbo or maybe a complete engine failure. And you know, not only that, you know, he failed to finish in Indonesia. Possum won there. This is two events in a row. It looks like his Asia Pacific series is gone for a year.
And of course, they're just starting to develop the Mitsubishi Lancer RS this year. Plagued with a few problems in some of the previous rounds of the World Rally Championships. And it looks like Possum Born has got the AP series well under control at this stage. All he's basically got to do now, a little bit of
a little sideways there, I think. You know, you sort of panic there and grab the e-brake, I think.
Well, you get those on wet roads, don't you, sometimes,
Ross? You certainly do. Oh, he's going past Ross there. He knows now that Ross is out of it for this year. All he's got to do is get a good, solid finish, and he's in for the Asia-Pacific.
Here's the French woman, Christine Driano, in the Little Wee Citroen, on the 12th seed, one of the Group A settings, because she's doing so well in the World Champs, but off the pace compared to the Group A cars. Colin McRae, the Scot, just hanging it loose in the Subaru. This is awesome stuff.
Yeah, but he's having his share of problems, just like the other guys.
Now take a look at this. No back window, smashed to smithereens.
At stage four, I think it was, we slid a bit wide and just caught a tree and broke the back window.
And also having a few problems in the Subaru. It's Possum Born this time. The top is getting a bit too close. He doesn't like that. Lost a
concentration. Oh, he's lost it. He spun it right around.
We went for the hard tyres and they were the wrong choice and it was really difficult to hold it, and then the helicopter put us off.
I heard that, yeah.
They're a pain in the arse. It's too close. Yeah. But anyway, and then we stalled it and it took a while to get it going and back up and get going, and away we went.
So disappointing there for Possum Board. Dropped back to the top 10, losing over a minute on the leaders. But of course, the real losers here, the Ford Escort team. Mickey Biasion rolled out of stage four, which means Francois Delacour is all by himself now. And at the end of day one, after 143 kilometres of nine special stages, there was only 43 seconds separating the top six drivers. Vartanen in front from Sainz, Delacour, Auriol, McRae and Kankinen. Born and Allport were the leading Kiwis in the top 10. Fujimoto led the battle of Group N, while six other Kiwis, McAndrew, Joblin, Austin, Watkin, Herbert and Ayling, rounded out the top 20. And day one was a bad day for the Ford Escorts, losing series leader Biasion and former national champ Brian Stokes. The second leg of the Rossmans Rally of New Zealand raced around the beautiful Bay of Plenty, but was dominated by Special Stage 12, the Motu. Compared to day one, leg two is the longest, toughest day of the rally. 11 special stages, 14 hours behind the wheel, covering 240 kilometres on the road to Gisborne and back. And first up, special stage 10, Manawahei, around Lake Rotama, 24 kilometres through the fast forestry roads.
Yeah, this road is fantastic. It starts out very tight and twisty, can be a little frosty, and you get a little sun in your eyes. Then it turns into a very fast road, returning back to a narrow, tight, twisty road.
And talking about being very fast, Ari Vartanen, the overnight leader, fastest through this stage to maintain his lead just by a few seconds.
And it's certainly setting a blistering pace.
Sliding into action, this is Didier Auriol, the first of the Toyota Celicas.
The Toyota's looking good and slowly moving up through the field.
Not quite as smooth as Ari Vartanen sometimes. And talking of smooth, this man was third fastest on the stage to move into second place overall, Delacour.
Yes, and I'm sure he's working on that strategy of trying to catch the guys in front.
Well, talking about trying to catch the guys in front, Colin McRae getting it sideways.
He's trying real hard. In fact, I'm really surprised he's trying so hard on the first stage of the day. You know, in fact, he could be even losing a little time. Yes, look at that. He's locking it up. He's losing a bit. He's going to nudge the bank. Yeah, that's going to cost him a bit.
But I tell you what, Rod, that's what the fans have come out to see. They love that sort of driving. Him and Ari Vartanen, very exciting. And the Subarus, what about Carlos Sainz?
Yeah, and he's trying as well. You know, I talked to Carlos. He's complaining that he's not getting very good traction. Maybe a tyre choice, or maybe it's even the suspension.
Always under pressure in the Lancia, trying to keep up with the pace of the Toyotas, the Fords, and the Subarus. But he's still in the top five, Carlos Sainz. And this is Joe McAndrew, the current leader of the three-sport National Rally Championship. All he basically has to do is keep it in the top four of the Kiwis to take home the title this year, and he'll be determined to do that. Now, the Group N Championship is turning out to be a real battle of the Mitsubishi Lancer Evolution models. This is the Japanese driver, Fujimoto, with a bit of a revolutionary way of getting around the corner.
It certainly is, and it's very surprising how fast these new Mitsubishis are in Group N.
Fujimoto leads Group N, and this is the guy who's second. A great drive by the Kiwi, Chris Joplin from Hawke's Bay, second also driving one of the Lancers as well. And here's one of your old makes, one of the Mazdas in Group N, Fasina.
Yes, but they're not quite as fast as the Mitsubishis these days.
He currently leads the World Championship in Group N. Talking of Group N, last year's national champions, Will and Heather Orr, back in the top 20 again this year. But going into Special Stage 12, it's the Mighty Motu. It's Ari Vatanen, the Flying Finn, who leads just by a couple of seconds in the Subaru Legacy. Right behind him in the Ford Escort Cosworth, it's Francois Delacour. And then 22 seconds behind the first of the Toyotas, Didier Auriol, followed by Colin McRae, the young Scot, 29 seconds off the pace in fourth place. And just a second behind him, the reigning world champion, Carlos Sainz, rounding out the top five. But incredibly, there's just 1 minute, round about 55 seconds, separating the top six drivers, with Juha Kankkonen next in the Toyota Celica.
There are about 1,000 corners on this stage. I try my best not to make a mistake. And I'm sure that the difference won't be 2 seconds, it will be more either way.
Well, good luck, we'll see you at the end.
Thank you.
The Flying Finn, Ari Vatanen, was first away on this 45-kilometre monster. Normally raced over two stages, this year it's been combined into one, the longest, toughest stage of the rally. Now, Vatanen inherited the overnight lead, but Delacour took a 20-second penalty so he wouldn't start first on the road after the drivers were reseated at the end of the first day. Delacour was so concerned about his first time through the Motu, he wanted to play follow the leader rather than set the pace. And by the time they started the Motu stage, Vatanen's lead had been cut to just 2 seconds. But then disaster. For the second time in 2 years, and for the second time this year, Vatanen was forced out of the rally while in the lead. The problem, broken lower suspension. For the Finn, the rally had finished. Second to have a go at the gravel was Carlos Sainz. The reigning world champ was 30 seconds behind in fifth place, still in touch with the leaders, despite the Lancia's lack of development this year. The Lancia Integrale has won the World Manufacturer's title for the last 6 years in a row. But now, that's it. And Sainz knows he's driving a car that's about to be retired. And along with it, will go his World Drivers' Championship and his New Zealand title as well. Didier Auriol was the hot tip by the rally drivers, teams and media before the start. Now we're starting to make his push in the Celica. He started 22 seconds behind in third, but finished only 5 seconds off the pace in second after a top drive through the Motu. Delacour was cautious in the race against the clock and cliffs. While he had gambled by giving away the lead, it was his gamble on a harder compound of tyres that really backfired and cost him 20 seconds on this man, Colin McRae. Not one to be outsighted, the young Scot, who turned 25 the day before, celebrated with an amazing display of car control and by using a softer compound of tyres. His reputation as careless was overtaken by his desire to be careful, but quick, very quick. He was 7 seconds faster than Oriel and took the lead after the Motu. A sign of things to come for Subaru. They had lost one leader, but found another. Still leading the Kiwi Challenge, Possum Bourne, but now 3 minutes back in seventh place after spinning, stalling and picking the wrong tyres on Special Stage 4. He reckoned it would take about 42 minutes to get through, so was very happy with his time of 39 minutes, but not so happy with the way he took this corner. Another 50 seconds behind in ninth place and second Kiwi was Neil Allport. But what started out as a good drive almost ended in disaster. Wellington's Joe McAndrew struggled early on in the second leg and complained about the road cutting up and lost more time with the late mishap in the Motu. Colin, 37.57, the fastest through the Motu.
I'm glad that's over.
How was it?
Very, very slippy, and just thought the finish was never coming.
Austrian Sepp Haider arrived at the finish before Allport. Did you see Neil Allport?
Yes, he just went off the road and stole up to his door. But he's coming back, I think so.
We put the car on side riding, not bad, it just missed. We lost grip on the tyres about halfway through, which I figured we were going to go, what's going to happen, and it just got worse and just miscued a corner and got on its side. And we had to get out, push it back on its wheels. Yeah, we lost a bit of time and, you know, not a lot of grip to the end of the stage. So,
well, I gather the roads were real slippery.
Well, I thought it was the tyres. Maybe it's the roads, but yeah, it was really bad this year.
So the drama continues, and also trying to stay out of trouble, Joe McAndrew, the current leader of the Three Sport National Rally Championship. Of course, it'll be decided by this rally, but he's lost a bit of time, so perhaps he's had a bit of trouble.
Goodbye, over.
How you doing, Joe?
Wretched, man.
What's the problem?
We just bent a back arm right through. We just done the last half of the stage, born crawling.
Is that right? What stage did you do that?
Just now.
Just towards the finish.
The right arm, over.
I'm going. See you later, mate. It's just a difficult stage. Just some second and third gear for 45 kilometres. It's quite difficult.
Change of tactic for you and Possum this afternoon?
Not really. Now we're leading by a few seconds from Oriel now, so we just have to try and keep that lead up. Depends how quick he goes now.
And not all of the 36 special stages were raced in daylight. Spectators were blinded by the light as the drivers kept the pace on in the race back to Rotorua. Didier Oriel and the Toyota Celica matching times with the Ford Escort of Delacour. Thank you. throwing plenty of light on the three-way battle of the dark was the sideways Subaru of the Flying Scot. So after 2 days and another 247 kilometres, you can see there is only 5 seconds between the top three drivers, 2 minutes back to Sains and Kankinen, and over 4 minutes to first Kiwi, Possum Bourne. Allport and McAndrew almost 10 minutes behind Trelleth, and the first Group N is Japanese driver Fujimoto, over 20 minutes behind Oriel. Places 11 to 17 are fairly close, with only 3.5 minutes separating them. Good to see Joblin, Sexton and Austin having a tight tussle behind Fassina's Group N Mazda. Will and Heather Orr continue to do well. Cat and mouse duel with the top three at the moment. What are your tactics for tomorrow in those shorter sprint stages?
Tomorrow to continue at the same rhythm, but the big advantage for me tomorrow is to start in the third position behind McRae and Oriel, and I think I have maybe tomorrow a fantastic vacuum cleaner in front of me, because Oriel and McRae, they can clean the road for me tomorrow.
Leg 3 starts from Rotorua and takes the field through 11 special stages before returning to Auckland. Mystery Creek is always a stage that provides surprises. For the 33 Kiwis in this year's Rothmans Rally of New Zealand, the battle to finish was just as intense as the race to be the first resident home. Rally pro Possum Bourne was the first Kiwi home 3 years ago when he finished fifth, and this year he also posted another good result. And while the fence stayed where it was, so too did Possum, first Kiwi home in sixth place. Allport chased hard but couldn't recover the lost time from the Motu and eventually finished eighth overall, still a good result. And after losing the national championship last year on the second to last stage, McAndrew had his sights firmly set on the finish in Possum's old car. Chris Joblin had been second at one stage in Group N, but dropped back to fourth and 14th overall. New Group N champ Brian Watkin had no first gear and clutch and nursed the Subaru home in 24th spot. Ross Meekings ran out of fuel and survived overheating problems in the Group N Celica to finish 40th. But Canterbury's Brian Stokes was forced out with a broken front wheel on day one. Kim Austin followed his win in the Ashley Forest Rally Sprint with a spirited drive to finish 13th overall in the Nissan Pulsar. First Kiwis home last year, Will and Heather Orr never made it to the finish this time. But another husband and wife combination did. David and Jane Black from Wellington lost first gear and had no reverse, but still finished second in their class for the two-wheel drive cars, bringing the Corolla home in 23rd spot. Now, the hubby and wife duo have been racing together for 8 years. The only time Jane wasn't David's co-driver, he went over a 75-foot cliff. So for 4 days, she could tell him where to go. This is one husband who would definitely listen. Barry Sexton had been on the pace before being forced out on day three.
Go! Look, Greg, back at the booth. Greg Graham and Steve Johnson.
And promising young Greg Graham in the Mazda was another who never made it to the finish. Perhaps it was something to do with his backseat driver. Former national chap Dave Ayling was forced out with gearbox and radiator problems on day two in the Group N Escort.
That boom over here.
And South Island's John Silcock was the only winner of the Rothman Scholarships to make it to the finish. 16th overall in the Mazda. And 83 national champ Malcolm Stewart was the first Kiwi home 8 years ago, fifth in an Audi Quattro. This time, he brought the Group N Audi S2 Coupe home in 20th place. Apoteki's Paddy Davidson and Rotorua's Warren Jones failed to finish with puncture and fuel problems in the Nissan. But the ladies did. Vanessa Slee and Judy Delewa in the little Subaru Vivio. After starting from position 60, the Kiwis doubled that by finishing 30th, first in their class up the 1300cc, and easily beat the two French women by 4 minutes. Now, one man who scared the living daylights out of himself and co-driver Bob Haldane was Joe McAndrew. He drove into serious drama at the end of the flying finish after special stage 21.
It was a really fast straight coming down there, and I just didn't slow enough, and it just pulled us in. We were pulling quickly on our roof within no time, and it was starting to fill up full of water, and we were panicking, trying to get out. We couldn't get the doors open, and there was a bit of panic there for a while, but yeah, we spent a bit of time in that swamp.
McAndrew eventually finished ninth to take the three-sport rally championship. Now, because the Rothmans is round eight of the world champs, it's the focus of media worldwide. It's the biggest annual sporting event of the year, attracting 1,600 participants, drivers, support crews and officials, some flying around in the 18 choppers following the field. The rally is reported to be worth around $12 million to the New Zealand tourist economy. And as top English rally reporter Martin Holmes says, it's not just the cars they come to see.
Rally sport is a sport which is outside the stadium. You've got yacht racing, but that doesn't help in this case. You've got cycle racing, you've got marathon running. But name any other major world sport, and it's all inside a stadium. Because the top teams are here, you've got the filmmakers here, you've got us here, you've got the writers. People are interested in the sport, but they're interested to see the sport, and they're either in still or motion pictures. And when you do that, they look at your country, they look to see, great, look at that place. It's subliminal, it's a second line of tourism promotion. But these days, nobody that much cares to read a tourist brochure. You're interested in your sport, I'm interested in mine. And if it happens to be New Zealand, it's New Zealand benefits, because that's what we can't help looking at.
The fourth and final leg takes the drivers north of Auckland to Helensville and the Kaipara Flats, before the final stage at the Riverhead Forest, then returning to Manukau City for the finish ramp. The rally, though, was far from over. And with the restricted servicing this year to try and cut the costs of the sport, even the winners up front have to get their fingers dirty. Seated cars can only be serviced at the end of every second stage, so in between, drivers like Carlos Sainz, yes, the multi-million dollar world champ, have to change the odd tyre or two. Now, would Ayrton Senna do that? Or Alain Prost do this? Not on your life. Special stage 25, Mystery Creek, 5.5 kilometres, spectacular sprint stuff for the spectators. One of your favourites, Rod?
It certainly has. You know, this is a stage, it's very sandy. The guys really love to stand on the gas and throw their cars around.
Okay, Toyota Celica driver Didier Auriol's first up, leading the rally, of course, from the start of the day. 9 seconds behind, though, going into the stage. He's under pressure. He's got to let rip.
He certainly does. You know, not only is the road very sandy, but it's very narrow. There's a lot of gateposts to get through. A lot of the drivers select normally a very narrow tyre. I always used to like a tyre that was very aggressive in the tread pattern.
And the rumour has it he's had a few problems, according to some of the spectators. They've smelt problems in the rear there.
Yes, they have. Apparently he's had diff problems all day.
Salika, he's lost a bit of time, still pretty quick though, 4:14. That means he's still in second place. Here is the man he's going to beat, of course, Subaru Legacy driver Colin McRae. What can he do this time? The man is out in front.
You know, I think Colin's going to enjoy this stage. If you look at the rest of the stages today, he looks really super and throws the car around a lot. This really will suit him.
Derek Ringer, Colin McRae third.
He's looking great, you know. And, oh, he's taking a bit of a shortcut through here. Well, that's a little quicker.
Classic Mike Marshall moves, wasn't it, for many years ago?
It certainly was.
Here he is, down to the second to last corner, whips it round.
And nice and tight as well.
4.13, that's
but up the
quickest.
Bank, but that's a little quicker though.
4.13, that's the quickest. He's 10 seconds in front now. And now third up with that mystery way around Mystery Creek. It's the Frenchman in the Ford, Francois Delacour. Even Stevens with Didier Auriol at the moment. Second, equal 9 seconds behind McRae. What can he do this time, Rob?
See, I don't think his driving style will suit this stage. This stage, you've got to throw the car around. It doesn't matter to be pretty wild and standing on the gas.
Mind you, it's a bit more like a racetrack for him, so he can let rip here. Slipping and sliding now, the Frenchman. Dusty too, just like Argentina. Recovers.
And nice and tidy around that last corner.
4.19, which means he's still in third place, 15 seconds behind McRae. So the action continues here at Mystery Creek. Next up, we've got the reigning world champion, Carlos Sainz. Of course, he's in fourth place, just under 2 minutes behind the leader and trying to catch up. He's been on the charge all day.
Carlos should do well here. He's done the stage many times before. He enjoys it as well. Just got to keep an eye on those gateposts.
Carlos Sainz, what can he do now? Of course, the fastest time has been a 4.13 by Colin McRae, and he's not quite as quick.
But neat and tidy around that last corner.
4.21, which means he's actually lost 10 seconds on the leader, so that's bad luck for Carlos. He'll be a bit disappointed with that. Next up, the triple world champion, Juha Kankkonen, 2 minutes 13 behind in fifth place at the start.
Now, this will suit Juha's style. You know, he'll fire the car around, he'll really stand on the gas.
The sort of style that you used to do, what, throw it in there?
Yeah, you just throw it in there and just point it and squirt it.
So across the ditch, Juha Kankkonen in the Toyota Celica, that crackling turbo.
Yeah, look at that. You know, he's well in control.
Whoa, oh, nice. Smokey and the Bandit.
He's got himself set up for the next corner. He's really going for it. It should be a real good time.
Kankkonen, what a cracker. On the pace, 4:14, which means he's still in fifth place. Finally, we've got Possum Bourne. What can the Kiwi do? Sixth place, just under 7 minutes behind the leader. He's out for a bit of fun.
I think he's out for a bit of grass, shortcuts and that. You know, you've really got to make the most you can get out of the stage.
Well, in a stage like this, which is basically a spectator sprint, I mean, how hard do you actually have to work like Roger and Possum in the cockpit there with the pace notes?
Well, you've got to work real hard. You know, pretty much the driver will memorize the course, but it's real important that the notes come through to make sure that you don't make any mistakes and don't do any guessing.
Fantastic shots here on 3 Sport with our rally cam pictures.
Around this last right-hander, look out for the tires. He clears it, and up the bank as well. Yes, that's the quick way around, I'm sure.
The shortcut, 4:19, which means he's still in sixth place. Spectacular stuff from Mystery Creek. The fourth and final day of the Rothmans Rally of New Zealand was set for a scintillating finish. 3 drivers and 3 different cars separated by just 30 seconds. Leading the chase against the clock, and for the first time on the rally, slightly wet conditions, it's Colin McRae. He lost 8 seconds to Delacour on special stage 33 near Helensville. But with a superb display of flat-out driving, McRae won the next 2 stages to increase his overall lead to 27 seconds. Delacour was caught in 2 minds. Ford needed second place for the points in the manufacturer's race against Toyota. But with 3 stages to go, Delacour was just 7 seconds behind in second. Should he go for victory or follow team orders and take the points? One man in no doubt was Didier Auriol. Toyota had 2 cars in the running. He knew teammate Juha Kankkonen would finish 5th and take the lead in the Drivers' Championship. And if he could snatch 2nd off Delacour, that'd give Toyota the lead in the Battle of the Manufacturers. Going into the last stage, he was just 11 seconds behind Delacour and going for it. But after 4 days and 591 kilometres, it was McRae who drove to victory.
Really, the second last stage today, we had a very good time. Until that point, Francois was only 7 seconds behind us, and it was looking a bit doubtful. So there was a small panic on after that. I think this morning when I went out, I was maybe a bit too relaxed and didn't try quite hard enough. So after that, once it got a bit closer, I picked the pace up again. And the second last stage, we really made the decision to try just as hard as we could and get a nice cushion before the last stage.
Second, 27 seconds behind for Ford was Delacour.
Last stage is short for you?
It's finished now.
Yeah.
The last stage was maybe 100 km for me because for us it's good for Colin win the rally, but the best for us was to be in front of the Toyota. It's much important, more important for the World Championship.
Good.
And anyway, it was impossible to catch Colin. Nice. Colin was going very, very fast, drive very well.
And pulling up to see his final stage time, Didier Auriol. Just look at his face as he realises he missed out on beating Delacour for second by just 2 seconds. All that hard work, and somehow even third place can't make up for the disappointment of being so close, but not close enough.
Great time.
So the 1993 Rothmans Rally of New Zealand went down in history as one of the closest, most exciting races ever. It was Colin McRae's first win in the World Rally Champs, also the first for Subaru. Incredibly, the first three places were less than 30 seconds apart after 500 kilometres of racing. So as the field head for the Thousand Lakes Rally in Finland later this month, Juha Kankkonen has a one-point lead in the Drivers' Championship over Francois Delacour, with Biasion and Auriol now followed by the fast-improving McRae. And in the race to take over the manufacturer's title from Lancia, it's now a two-way tie between Toyota and Ford, although Toyota have 4 wins compared to Ford's 3. And finally, from the 76 starters, there were 46 finishes. And from the super-fast McRae to the super-slow Bharat Dhavi. Yes, even though he was 5.5 hours behind in last place, at least the colourful Indian still got to the finish.
It's a heavy shop overturns, this car. So I have to drive carefully and have to some troublesome in driving. But today's road is too wet. So my car is just like dancing here and there. So it is very dangerous. I all the way fill my petrol on the highways, on the petrol pumps, and going on the ahead.
And what about your pace notes? How did that go there?
We don't care about the pace note.
No pace notes?
No pace notes.
Why is that?
Yeah, it's a, if you can see and you can go. I think so. It is not necessary for the pace. Not
easy, see the road, turns right, just
turns right and go. Yeah.
Now, did you actually stop and take a photo one day?
No.
They thought you loved the countryside so much, one of the officials said you actually stopped and took a photo.
No, that officer saying I think so, he may be in the good mood.
We'll be right back.
We'll be right back.